what I had inadvertently done was discovered these indivisible stochastic processes and shown that there was just a change of mathematical representation that would take such a system with classical-like configurations, could be a system of particles, could be a system of fields, whatever we're trying to model. And if it has indivisible stochastic laws, then through this mathematical representation, this correspondence, you get a Hilbert space picture.
That's super interesting.
Yeah. And all the weirdnesses of the Hilbert space picture, superposition of states, interference effects, these are all related to what are called coherences, phases, right? All these things are connected to superposition, interference, and coherences. These could be understood now. They could be given a meaning. So in textbook quantum theory, these things don't have meanings. They're just pieces of mathematics that show up in the formalism. We don't understand what they mean. We know that interference shows up in experiments. We know that these things called phases or coherences or superpositions, we see these show up in all over the place. But they don't directly have a physical meaning. We don't know what they represent or what they really mean. What I was able to show is that in going from this very physically concrete picture of objects of a clear ontology, probabilistically evolving in this indivisible way, in going from that picture to a picture with a nice Schrodinger equation, where the evolution is divisible, it's a nice differential equation, very familiar mathematics, in going to that picture that looks divisible, you have to give something up. That indivisibility doesn't disappear. It becomes all those weird phases, interference effects, and coherences. That's how they manifest in this picture. It's like there's no free lunch. If you want a picture that's mathematically convenient and simpler, a picture where you can evolve a system any amount of time you want, pause, re-evolve, a nice divisible dynamical picture, you have to pay the price. And the price is that all that indivisibility becomes these weird phases. In some very loose sense, if you want to think roughly speaking of these indivisible processes as being like processes with memory, all those interferences and phases, those are the memory encoded in this strange way. And that's the picture.
That's fantastic.
Yeah. So in this picture, there's no fundamental role for a wave function. I mean, you just have objects bouncing around according to laws that are more general than the laws of Newtonian mechanics or even the laws of a Markov process. And if you want to model a measurement, you just model another system that interacts with your first system, give the whole thing a nice simple set of stochastic, indivisible stochastic dynamics. And what you'll find is that the measuring device will stochastically evolve into one of its final readout configurations with exactly the correct probability that we would expect from the Born rule. But there's no wave function, there's no collapsing. It's just some big stochastic process happening.
So what's doing the choosing of what interval to make that time? You said that you can choose any interval, but then you can't choose a subinterval.
Right. This is an excellent question. So in order to get an indivisible stochastic process started, you need a time at which you can begin, right? And then the process tells you probabilistically where the system will end up at really any smooth choice of later time. But is there just one special time where things can get started? The answer is no. What you can show is that when you have a system interacting with some larger system, so not left to itself, interacting with some larger system, what you find is that if this larger system is exchanging information with your original system, as would happen if you've got like a measuring device reading out the configuration of your system, then when it does this, you just let the stochastic process tell you what happens. There's no axiom here. You let it evolve, and what you discover is that you get a division event. The evolution divides at that moment, seen from the point of view of the smaller system. And now there's a new time at which the evolution breaks, and you can start now again from that new time. So in an indivisible stochastic process, it's not that there are no times where you can divide. There are times at which you can break up the evolution, but the times aren't given to you at the beginning. They're not fundamental. They arise from mutual interactions between systems. Now, when you ask, what does this look like from the Hilbert space point of view, in the standard textbook quantum mechanical picture, the Hilbert space point of view, what do those division events look like? They look just like decoherence. So decoherence, again, is when a big system interacts with maybe a smaller system, the environment comes in, interacts with the system, exchanges information, and we get these changes to the quantum state of the other system, changes that don't single out one answer, but do change it in some way. Those changes kill off the coherence effects, they kill off interference effects. From the point of view of the indivisible stochastic process, they just look like the generation of a new moment, a new division event, an event where the evolution can be started again. And this happens at the end of measurements. And this is a physical process in this picture. And it coincides with what you would call a measurement. But it's generated by the laws of this picture themselves.
Okay, I'm confused. So division events, is that just another relabeling of what a measurement is?
Good question. So in a way, sort of, if you give me a second system that I model explicitly. So let me phrase it a different way. In the textbook Axioms of Quantum Theory, measuring devices are treated as outside the formalism, right? They're kind of in the background. They're kind of like the person behind the curtain, right? We do a measurement and we just sort of change the quantum state of the system being measured, but we don't usually explicitly put the measuring device into the description itself. If you try to do that, if you try to put the measuring device into the description, what you find after a measurement is that the measuring device and its possible readout configurations become entangled with the possible configurations of the system being measured. There's this entanglement that happens. And the question is, well, then what? Now they're entangled, what do I do? What you're supposed to do is collapse down to one of those entangled branches. That's the collapse. Now, if there's a bigger environment that comes in, and the bigger environment looks at the measuring device, then it gets entangled with the measuring device. And there's this operation, this sort of formal operation where you can kind of ignore the environment. And you see that there's a suppression of all the interference effects, but still no singling out of one outcome. You have to, at some point, pull the fifth axiom, you know, activate it, and collapse down to one thing at some point. In this indivisible picture, you can bring in that measuring device, you bring it in, you let the overall system evolve stochastically, and what you find is that, and bring in an environment, the environment comes in, you can treat them all as actual systems. None of them are outside the formalism, they're all modeled as systems in the formalism. And what you find is when you let these systems evolve, the system being measured and the measuring device probabilistically evolve toward the configurations that we would expect from the, you know, collapse axiom. And because of the environment, you can show that the measuring device and the subject system, they experience a division event at almost exactly the moment of the interaction that we would call a measurement. And this division event means that you can now restart the laws and start them from this moment. This division event is not postulated, it's not an axiom. It's something that just shows up from the usual rules of probability theory when you actually model the systems explicitly. So in a way, it is a measurement, but it doesn't require a conscious being. It doesn't require a human. Any system that has a robustly large number of moving parts, we call them degrees of freedom, in contact with a nice big environment with a big number of degrees of freedom, will to an extremely high level of precision produce measurement results that probabilistically coincide with what we would expect from textbook quantum theory, and will generate a moment at which the stochastic dynamics of the system being measured and the measuring device can be restarted and have their own dynamics. So yes, in a way it's a measurement, but it lets us get inside the measurement. It lets us see the measurement actually happen, and it gives us a way to understand why measurements do this thing rather than merely positing that they collapse wave functions.
So do you require three different systems to be stated? So the environment, the measurer,
yeah,
and the measured?
Yes. That's right. And we require that in standard quantum measurement theory anyway, in the usual textbook theory.
The environment as well?
The environment is needed, yeah. Yep. Because the usual argument is that the environment is what generates the decoherence of the measuring device and the system being measured. But when you say the environment, I mean, in any realistic measuring device, you have, you know, the part of the measuring device that's actually directly engaged in the measurement, but then you have the rest of the measuring device. I mean, it's a big object, it's in a box, it's got dials, it's got other experimental things on it. I'm sorry, this is me not being a very good experimentalist again. But that's, yeah, so there's almost invariably always an environment.
So you firstly describe the environment, the measurer, and the measured classically, and then you do some, your version of a quantizing procedure?
Yeah, so you model them classically in the sense that they have classical-like configurations. The measuring device is some system, some physical object that can be in different possible configurations. Among those, we include at some level of coarse graining. We include, you know, the system is empty, it doesn't yet show a reading, the system shows spin up on the dial, the system shows spin down on the dial, you know, like, but these are concrete configurations made of particular configurations of the constituent atoms, whatever you want. So that is to say that their configurations, their ontology, their physical existence is visualized in a roughly classical way. The quantum part is that the laws they satisfy are not deterministic differential equations like Newton's law or Newton's laws or the Maxwell's laws of electromagnetism. The laws we give them are these indivisible stochastic laws, which we don't usually see in classical systems. The claim is that when you give these systems these more general kinds of laws, that's enough to make them behave like quantum systems.
Don't forget to follow Theories of Everything with Kurt Jaimungal on Spotify for exclusive content and in-depth discussions. Your support on Spotify helps us grow and to reach more curious minds like yours. Check out the link in the description and join the CoreTo community on Spotify today. See you there.